Hello everybody, this is Arthur van Zanten from the Netherlands. I'm head of the ICU and research in Gelderse Vallei Hospital in Ede and also a professor at the Division of Nutrition and Health at Wageningen University and Research. Today I'd like to talk with you about the practical use of vasopressin. So here you see my disclosures. Most important is that I have received honoraria and research grants from Amomed, who makes RG-Prison. So when we consider vasopressors in shock, we have to consider that we use norepinephrine or noradrenaline as a life-saving drug. But we see that patients on the highest dosages of this drug have increased mortality. And of course, this is due to the severity of illness. But over the last years, there is also much attention on the harmful effects of these vasopressors. So it may induce injury to myocardial cells, induce oxidative stress, and have an effect on the immune system. And in these two important papers published over the last few years, this research group has proven that when we give norepinephrine to our patients in septic shock, this is studies in mice, but also in humans, that it affects the immune response and it compromises the host defense during sepsis. And when you compare these effects with vasopressin, there is no effect of vasopressin on the immune system. So this may suggest that we should combine or maybe prefer other vasopressors than norepinephrine. And of course, when we have pathological vasodilation, as happens in septic shock in many conditions in the ICU, we have to impact on the vascular smooth muscle cells, and they have to contract to restore blood pressure. And it can be done by noradrenaline, as we all know, but it can also be done, and more papers are appearing over the last few years with angiotensin and vasopressin. And particularly vasopressin is interesting because we know that in the late phase of septic shock, there is a vasopressin deficiency. And when we restore this vasopressin deficiency, this positively affects the blood pressure that has been shown in many studies. If we consider vasopressin, it has several effects. So we have the V1 receptor mainly causing vasoconstriction. And the V2 receptor is important for water retention in the kidney. And the V3 or V1b receptor is involved in the secretion of ACTH. And by doing this, stimulates the cortisol release from the adrenal gland, important also in conditions of septic shock. And for years, we have in the guidelines that we have to consider to add another, a second vasopressor on top of norepinephrine, and that could be either vasopressin up to a dose of 0.03 units per minute or epinephrine. Both have weak recommendations because we don't have many studies on this topic yet, but the number of studies is increasing. So we should not increase the norepinephrine dose to very high dosages, but add a second vasopressor. That's at least the recommendation of the Surviving Sepsis campaign. Now we have this problem of when to start this second vasopressor. And what we do is that we have defined a refractory vasodilatory shock, because there is not a real definition, but we use a definition of 0.25 micrograms per kg per minute of norepinephrine infusion in a patient, and when it's higher than that level, we consider this refractory vasodilatory shock, and then we start adding vasopressin to the norepinephrine. In the literature, we know that, well, there is not a difference in mortality. This was studied by Russell in the New England Journal of Medicine, published in 2008. But there was a marked effect of catecholamine in saving or sparing effect. And you see in this slide, the norepinephrine dosages are much lower in the patients treated with vasopressin. And in a post hoc analysis of this study, you can see that when we take those patients with a lower Apache 2 score and lower lactate levels, that even the probability of mortality is lower. So this suggests that we should not use vasopressin addition in those patients with very severe shock and very high dosages of norepinephrine, but maybe should start a little bit earlier. And of course, many of you, and as we did for long, we used telepressin, another vasopressin analog. But you can see from this study that it comes with a price. So there are many reported serious adverse events. And this may have to do with the effect that the telepressin has a very long half-life. So when you give it on a continuous infusion, you get increasing dosages. And from this meta-analysis by McIntyre, published in JAMA, we know that if you summarize all the studies done with vasopressin and a catecholamine versus a catecholamine alone, that you see a reduction in the incidence of new onset atrial fibrillation in patients with distributive shock. So it's a 23% less atrial fibrillation. And there is also, when you summarize all the studies, an 11% lower mortality at 1 month in distributive shock. And there is also a trend, it was not significant, towards less renal replacement therapy in distributive shock. It was 24% lower incidence, but didn't meet the criteria for statistical significance. But also with vasopressin, there is a higher likelihood of inducing ischemia, especially more digital ischemia. So that's important to observe in your patients and could be a reason to reduce the vasopressin infusion rates. So if you summarize the results from this study, you see, well, there is high quality evidence that it reduces atrial fibrillation. There may be a reduction in mortality and also a reduction in renal replacement therapy. And from a more recent meta-analysis by Nedel, you can see that the need for renal replacement therapy and the incidence of AKI, so acute kidney injury, is lower in favor of patients who were treated with vasopressin or analogs like vasopressin. So you can choose either vasopressin or epinephrine, but from this recent meta-analysis, you can see that those vasopressors that increase the heart rate, that there is an increased trend for mortality. But those vasopressors that reduce the heart rate, like vasopressin or has a neutral effect on heart rate, there is a trend to decrease mortality. So this is a reason that we favor vasopressin as a second vasopressor over epinephrine, because it will increase the heart rate. So we made this protocol for ICUs in the Netherlands, and it is now used in a study. I will tell you a little bit more. So when we meet the criteria of refractory shock, after, of course, we have used adequate fluid resuscitation, we have hemodynamic monitoring, and we have increased the norepinephrine doses up to 0.25 micrograms per kg per minute. And still the mean arterial pressure is insufficient to the discretion of the attending physician. We do not increase the norepinephrine, but now we start argypressin. And we do this in three steps. And in the upper part, you can see that the argypressin dose, you can dissolve this 2 ml 40 units ampules in saline, and then you have syringes of 50 ml. And in three steps, you can build up this doses from 0.01 international units per minute up to 0.03. And you see the infusion rates of the syringes. So in three steps, you evaluate the effect on blood pressure. And when the blood pressure now is insufficient, you start decreasing the norepinephrine until you reach the level of norepinephrine 0.10 micrograms per kg per minute. And then it's time to gradually taper the argypressin. And when this is successful, you go by steps of 1 hour of 0.1 international units of RT pressing, and you decrease until you can stop. If the blood pressure drops, you restart or increase the doses again by these three steps of RT pressing dosing. And you can use it in septic shock, but also you can use it in pulmonary hypertension because there are no vasopressin receptors in the pulmonary arterial system. So you have to beware of rebound hypotension. And that's also found in this meta-analysis. You have to reduce the norepinephrine levels to very low dosages before you start tapering the vasopressin. Otherwise, you get a rebound hypotension. And this is preliminary data from our registry in the Netherlands. And you can see there is a huge effect on the saving of norepinephrine. You see in blue, the blue line, that norepinephrine levels go down very much, but you see a rebound. So we have to taper a little bit more before we start reducing the vasopressin levels. We started an investigator-driven registry in the Netherlands, supported by AMOMED International. We made an eCRF for the patients with refractory shock treated with vasopressin to study the efficacy, safety, complications, average dose, tapering efficacy, whether we should reduce vasopressin first, the incidence of restart, the cost and cumulative dosages in patients. So this cohort of this patient group in the registry will be studied and published in the future. So to conclude, I think that high dose norepinephrine or noradrenaline monotherapy may not be the best. It has an effect on the immune system, as I told you. And there is a catecholamine sparing effect, and it treats also vasopressin deficiency in sepsis when you use vasopressin. It may reduce atrial fibrillation, AKI, and renal replacement therapy, and possibly mortality. We have a practical protocol, and we have started a national investigator-driven registry. The patients in the registry are used in a prospective cohort study, and a network approach may provide insights soon. So I hope to give you the results in future presentations in this ISICEM Congress. Thank you for your attention.